Visit our fabulous sponsor, Caught Gold Jewelry, link in the description below. Hello, fabulous friends, fans, and superstars. Welcome to your horoscope for the week of April 28, 2019. I am your astrologer, Nadia Shaw. Thank you for being here. What an amazing week it is. We do have an active sky, and it starts right out of the gate. Right around Tuesday, give or take a day on either side, depending on where you are on the planet, Saturn will officially go retrograde. Now, Saturn will stay retrograde right to the middle of September. However, it is when a planet is changing directions that its energy is thought to be most powerful. And there are a few reasons for that. For one, visually, for the ancients, a planet was standing still in the sky with its energies focused and concentrated. But also, when it is that a planet is changing directions, it is especially close to the Earth. And because of that closer proximity than it may otherwise have, is part of why it has been understood that this energy is especially pronounced at this time. Now think about Saturn. Saturn is a representation of a few things. And up until very recently in human history, up until the 1770s, with the discovery of Uranus, it was thought that Saturn was the limits of the universe. It was the absolute edge of the known world. And as it was that we came to know more about ourselves and we expanded our perception about what was possible for us as human beings, so too did the sky reflect that, and we had this leap of consciousness that came along with the discovery of Uranus. So up until very recently in human history, it was Saturn, and that was it. And so Saturn came to be known for a few things, symbolically speaking, old age, legacy in particular, success as well. It became known for what it is that we are known for on a larger sense, the lineage that we leave behind that others will carry forward. It also is often understood, especially to us in modern astrology, that Saturn represents our own sense of limitations and the responsibilities that we hold. It can feel, it has been called an Achilles heel, but I think that that is when we are not using our Saturn well. It is something that I've observed after looking at a lot of charts. When you start out studying astrology, as I did many moons ago, way back then, there wasn't really the internet. I mean, I'm sure there was the internet, but it wasn't really something that was a part of mass culture, mass consciousness. And so what we did when we wanted to look at charts is you went to the New Age bookstore, and they had these catalogs there, like the Astro Data Bank catalogs, and you could look up different celebrities there. And what was very notable to me, you know, when I first started looking at charts, you start with celebrities because their life is so public. And I remember looking at these charts, expecting to see all kinds of grand trines and Jupiter everywhere. And I was shocked to find that that isn't the case, really. What we see with people who are notable, who make an impact on their communities, maybe are known on a larger scale as well, we will often see, well, one of the aspects we often see are squares. Squares tend to be dominant. And squares are a conversation of tension that I will talk about in a bit, given what is happening in the sky this week. But essentially, they are conversations of motivation. And it is the trines that I expected to find and the grand trines, which are supremely harmonious connections. But the thing is, supremely harmonious connections, we sometimes take them for granted. We think and we feel like things are good, and so we don't necessarily back up the opportunity with effort the way that we might with a square or a sextile, which is also harmonious, but has that little bit of motivation of a square into it. Now that is like my own kind of crude understanding of that, okay? So it's not, there are a lot of subtleties to it. It may not be just as simple as saying, well, a sextile is like a little bit of a trine and a little bit of square. Not really, but It is considered an easy aspect, but it's got just enough challenge in it so that you can make the most of the opportunities that may present themselves. So, squares. Shocked to find squares all over the charts of these successful people. And the other thing as well that surprised me, given that I had read so much up until that point that talked about Saturn as limitation, as the Achilles heel, as, you know, the thing that you think holds you back, but actually in the charts of people who are quite accomplished, you often will see strongly placed Saturn. And that is because Saturn represents diligence. It represents an eye to the big picture. And it speaks to a sense of working, a sense of moving and building, and a sense of ownership and responsibility for your own success, yes, but I've come to understand it as much deeper. It is a sense of responsibility for your own happiness. That is what Saturn represents. And wherever it is that Saturn is in your chart, you are in some way asked to take responsibility in that area of life. But it is ultimately responsibility for yourself, for your own choices, and to understand that you do have choice, to understand that it is by honoring the earthly incarnation. It is not by going to Neptune and escaping into clouds and what you believe and what could be, but rather it is based on what you actually do that a more grounded and real self-respect can be earned by you. And I have come to understand in this way that Saturn can actually be a great gift. Saturn can actually help us make tremendous gains, mainly because we feel responsible. And because we feel responsible, we're taking action. We're doing the things that you need to do to actually move yourself in a direction that you desire to go. So wherever it is that Saturn is moving through in your chart, or where Saturn is based on your sun sign or your moon sign or your rising sign, right now, as Saturn is right smack dab in the middle of a better part of the 3-year transit through the sign of Capricorn, this represents an area of life for you. Again, depending on your rising sign, your moon sign, and your sun sign. And whatever area of life is being highlighted here, it is going to be an area that you are being encouraged to take ownership for the outcomes that you want, to understand the value of focus, of giving yourself determinedly in a singular direction. And it is also about doing your best and surrendering the rest. Well, really, let me just say, I think that the way that we resolve and we work with and we make the most of Saturn is by doing our best and surrendering the rest. I think I tripped over my words there a little bit. Surrendering the rest. It is by taking action and then releasing the outcome and just trusting that it is going to count for something in the fullness of time, even if the evidence isn't there right away, even if we have to try lots of different things to get us in a general direction that we are wanting to go, that effort is going to count for something in the fullness of time. So Saturn can also represent delays. Saturn likes to reward you, yes, but it is based on what you have given. It's sort of like an equal exchange. As much as it is that you give is as much as you will get back, but you may not get it back right away. Again, it's about the fullness of time that the rewards can be reaped. So a part of Saturn sometimes, as I said, limitations. It can feel like there are external blocks that show up when you have Saturn moving through a particular part of a sky for the better part of the 3 years. So that area of life starts to feel a little bit more challenging, but more than that, it starts to feel like there's some insecurity there. So you've got to pay attention. You've got to be more honest with yourself and give it work. But the honest with yourself part comes with the retrograde. It is retrograde energy that becomes more reflective. It goes inward. And it asks us to look at ourselves and our own role in whatever circumstances we have manifested in that particular area of life. And where it comes to Saturn, the key word is manifest, right? It is about what you are actually doing. And again, honoring the earthly incarnation, honoring the fact that, yes, we are spiritual beings and we are having an earthly experience, but that is actually an equation. And the earthly experience is here for a reason. It is here to fuel our spiritual beingness and our spiritual understanding and our spiritual growth and what I like to call our full ownership of the energy of love and wisdom in this lifetime. And so Saturn actually helps us to do just that. It helps us to find that balance between inspiration and soul and mind and matter and the earth and flesh, and knowing that we are here and we are embodied and we are in this life right now for a reason. And it is when we are in this life and we honor the rules of the physical plane that we can make gains that actually end up helping us to feel stronger. But not only that, actually help us to create a legacy that we can be proud of. And so it's not good to emphasize one over the other. I think that that becomes a problem, and we see this in different cultures around the world where one particular archetypal energy becomes more pronounced, becomes more idealized, and other energies become less so. It is ultimately about balance, and it is about recognizing that we are multifaceted human beings. We have a whole universe of planets in us, a part of us. And we have a whole universe of planets in our natal chart. And actually, the natal chart only touches the surface. As part of the mystery, when you are looking at a chart, if you're lucky, you will have moments where you glimpse the mystery, where you get to see beyond, where you get to take the chart and elevate the chart and speak truth to the client or speak truth to yourself. But at the end of the day, there is this whole batch of planets and asteroids, and they are all a part of you. So you don't want to overemphasize just one thing, but yes, very often certain planets will be especially strong in certain charts than they may be for others. So coming back to right now, Saturn goes retrograde. So we are asked to look within, to consider. Last week with Pluto, it was to be the change we wish to live, because Pluto has to do with change. Well, now it is to be the stability that we wish to experience in our life, to actually own our own self-respect and to earn our own self-respect where we need to accept ourselves more deeply where we need to, so that we can actually do more of what it is that's going to allow us to feel more grounded. And what does it mean to feel more grounded? It means to be at peace. It means to not feel like you're floating or flying away, but rather you have that balance where you are appreciating your incarnation. So that has to do with Saturn in the early part of the week. And this energy we will be feeling throughout this week. And for some of us, it's going to be more important than it might for others. It's going to be more reflective for some of us than it might for others. A good sort of note to remember is that where it is that you have a retrograde planet in your natal chart, when a planet by transit goes retro, its energies actually become a little bit more easier for you to access, a little bit more comfortable for you to access, because that planet by transit, where the planet is right now, is operating in a way that some part of you is more comfortable with, because some part of you came into this life with that energy. So that's why they say, for example, the big retrogrades that we tend to pay attention to are Mars and Venus, right? Last year, big year for Mars and Venus retrograde seasons. Well, I was saying at the time, if you have Mars retrograde in your chart, Mars retrograde will be experienced very differently by those who natally have Mars retrograde. A Venus retrograde that is happening by transit, for example, again, we had that last year, is going to be experienced very differently by someone who has Venus retrograde in their natal chart, regardless of what sign that retrograde falls in. And since Saturn likes to go retrograde for months at a time, like 5 months or so at a time each year, lots and lots of people are born with Saturn retrograde in their chart. So if you are a person, if you know your chart even a little bit, and you understand that you have Saturn retrograde there, well, then this should be a time that should feel like a special embrace, if you will. Now, I'm not promising you necessarily easy, but what I am saying is, as Saturn changes direction, as Saturn goes retro in the early part of the week, the realizations and the deeper layer of acceptance that you feel are going to mean that much more to you. Now, as we move further into the week, right in the middle of the week, that is when Mercury starts kicking up. Mercury will be very active this week, but it's all happening in the second part of the week. So right around Wednesday, it starts and takes us right towards the late part of the week, and it starts with a beautiful connection between Mercury and Mars. Now, these two planets right now are in what astrologers call mutual reception. There is a natural synergy that takes place between those two planets, even if they're not necessarily communicating with each other with precision. But that's not the case right now, because it is this week, right in the middle of the week, that Mars, in the sign of Gemini, the ruling planet of Aries, will be speaking with Mercury in Aries. And Mercury is the ruling planet of Gemini. And these planets will be speaking in a harmonious connection that I mentioned earlier. Astrologers call it a sextile. It is one of some motivation and some opportunity that, if taken, can help to realize even greater blessings. So I see this energy playing out in interesting ways for us. So on the one hand, I feel like there is this emphasis on mind that is taking place here, on exchanging ideas, on words, on rhetoric, on information. So there's going to be a lot of conversations happening. Now, we're going to notice this as a collective, but certainly in our own lives as well. Some particularly passionate exchanges can happen at this time before a more measured approach starts to set in. And also keep in mind, right, when we're talking about conversations, we're also talking about our conversations with ourselves. And how is it that we are talking with ourselves? The invitation here is to be diligent, to make sure that we are speaking to others and to ourselves in ways that are encouraging and in ways that are empowering, because that is where this energy can really start to shine. And it is actually a really great time to consider what more information you may need, or to just be open to being in the right place at the right time and connecting with the right person and coming across exactly what it is that you were hoping to know, or something better. When we have energy like this playing out, the awareness of synchronicity can be very high for us as a collective. So it really is one of those powerful times. However, the energy does change as we move later into the week. It is going to be Mercury that reaches out to Saturn and then reaches out to Pluto. Now, these connections are ones of tension. And it is these tense connections that are particularly interesting to me for a few reasons. This is limitation, right? As I mentioned, I talked about Saturn quite a bit. Yeah, an awareness of where it is that it's okay, or it feels safe, or it's right, or it is wise to say something, and where it is that maybe it isn't. Realizing that sometimes it is healthy and it is good to practice restraint, especially where it comes to what it is that we are sharing with others, however spontaneously that may be. And that connection with Pluto reminds us that words can hurt. Words can have huge consequences as well. And it's not just to the person who's receiving the words, but also the person who is saying the words as well. Because for the most part, if you are a healthy person who desires psychological balance, right? If you desire to move in a direction of greater love and greater wisdom, or just move in a direction of being more at peace with yourself, then chances are you don't intentionally walk around wanting to hurt people. You don't intend to speak to people in ways that would make them not feel good, or that would provoke a particular reaction that could just create a momentum that is not empowering to anybody at all, right? And so in these situations, it is actually a really good thing to be able to hold back. But where we want to be mindful is to ensure that where it is that we are holding back is coming from a place of wisdom. But sometimes the act of courage is saying that thing that is difficult, but it is coming from a pure place within you. It is coming from a place that knows that you must say something, that to not say anything would actually create more pain than if you actually said something. Sometimes it is a fine line. Sometimes if we take that little bit of a breather, if we take that little bit of a moment, we can check ourselves, as they say, to ensure that our intentions are coming from that place of love. Both come from a place of love and wisdom, but it is about how you use that power and how it is that you are going to choose your expressions, wisely or otherwise. Now, the thing to be mindful with this, of course, is that if you know that there are people in your life who aren't necessarily thinking about the evolution of their soul and about love and wisdom, the energy this week, and again, if you know that you're around people who can be toxic, some of that energy can be highlighted as we move later into the week. And I'm really sorry to say that. But whatever it is that does come up, know that it has its wisdom, and that wisdom is going to be revealed before we even get to the very end of the week. And that is because Mercury will speak in supreme harmony with Jupiter. I love this energy. I feel like this energy is just getting the right information at the right time. It's an energy of good news, of news that helps you to feel like you have lightened your load, that you have so much to look forward to, that there is hope, that there is optimism, and every reason to be optimistic. And for a lot of people, the good news can be practical opportunity as well. And I feel like what this week is saying is that what starts off as being witty and courageous and a quick idea can translate into having to look at our own fears, or having to address the fears of others or the resistance of others. But it is in navigating that that we will get to that place where we actually reap reward very quickly for what otherwise would just have stayed a good idea if you didn't follow it up with action. Now, there are different subtleties to this and different ways in which it'll play out in your own individual journey, especially depending on where these planets are placed for you at this time. But regardless, know that whatever it is that feels challenging, and some of us are going to feel that energy of challenge, that energy of a difficult decision, that energy of trying to figure out the right words to say and to whom to say it to. But regardless of that, know that as you navigate those feelings, you don't put them aside, you address them, you take it as the learning opportunity it is, you continue to take action to move forward. It is going to be what was tense that transforms into something even better than you anticipated. Now, this even better is further affirmed by the beautiful, absolutely beautiful new moon that we are ending the week with. Now, this energy is happening right at the end of the week, so this is energy we'll actually be feeling into next week as well. And this new moon is happening in the sign of Taurus, and it is speaking in supreme harmony with Pluto and with Saturn. And it is also going to speak in harmony with Neptune as well. So that Pluto and Saturn connection, that's pretty clear, right? What was a difficult conversation or words exchanged? Well, this is where you're able to understand more, and you're able to transform and parlay yourself into new opportunities, and brand new beginnings become possible here. For some, it may be that they're able to take that circumstance and transform it, change hearts and change minds. But for others, it is going to be a brand new situation that shows up that allows you to feel empowered and allows you to feel like your life is moving in a direction of greater stability. And I spoke earlier about being at peace with yourself, behaving in a way that allows you to look at yourself in the mirror with integrity. Well, it is this beautiful energy under this new moon that will ensure that we are operating from that place of integrity and manifesting from that place as a result. Now, that connection with Neptune with this new moon, I love that connection as well, because I feel like that is inspiration. That is faith. That is a sense of connection to each other, to everyone, to everything. And having compassion for ourselves and others is highlighted by this beautiful connection with Neptune to the new moon. Now, this new moon is happening in the sign of Taurus. What is the big deal with the sign of Taurus, right? What is everybody talking about? The fact that Uranus recently moved into the sign of Taurus for a nice long stay. But this new moon is nowhere near Uranus. So that's something to keep in mind. It doesn't really have that surprise, shocking quality necessarily. I mean, yes, the moon will meet Uranus on its way to becoming new, but that will be happening under the dark of the moon. So I feel like the surprise shock energy won't be too strong. It's more going to feel like an energy that has been under the surface, that's been building for a while, that's helping us to get honest, that's helping us to facilitate meaningful and in some cases profound change in our life. But the sign of Taurus is very practical. Remember that as well. It cares about enjoying the earthly incarnation. It cares about the fact that we are here in bodies right now with five senses, and we can enjoy whatever senses we may have, five or four or three or whatever, that we can enjoy ourselves regardless, that we can appreciate being embodied right here and right now. And also, of course, the sign of Taurus also has to do with finances, it has to do with money, it has to do with luxury purchases as well. And so as a collective, we may be looking at that more as well, talking about that as well. And we may see some very notable, perhaps celebrated, perhaps just notable, but some very strong examples of this lifestyles of the rich and famous stuff going around. So we'll be talking about that as well. And of course, I do think that now, more than ever before, the great thing is that we are more connected than ever. And that presents a great opportunity, right? To know that you are not alone, regardless of who you are, regardless of what you feel, regardless of how alien you have felt. I mean, this is one of the reasons I go to astrology conferences. And of course, you know, I'm going to talk about that a little bit later. But I love to go to astrology conferences because it really is like coming home. It really is like a family. It is like being an alien in your regular life and you're an astrologer, but you don't know where it is appropriate to tell people that you're an astrologer, right? But then you go there and everyone's speaking astrology and they just get it. You know, you don't have to say, oh, I'm feeling this way, I'm feeling that way. You can just say, oh yeah, Pluto is doing this in my chart, and it's enough, and everybody gets it and everybody understands. So it's a very powerful experience. And the great thing is that we get that experience in a way, like in our online world, but that online world is that Mars-Mercury energy that I spoke about earlier that's happening in the middle of the week. There is that emphasis on cerebral energy, digital energy, right? So it's not necessarily embodied. It's real, it's part of our experience, but it doesn't have the type of realness that a new moon in Taurus does. Because a new moon in Taurus invites us and reminds us that we are here to experience, and we are here to live, and we are here to actually be engaged in our lives and with each other. But the thing is, the more that you allow yourself to be known or to know others, the more vulnerable that we can become as well. But one thing I do like, at least with the sign of Taurus, is that it has a strong sense of self. So yes, we're more likely to want real human touch and real human experiences at this new moon, but also have a strong enough sense of self to be willing to go out there and actually connect with others. What I love about this week for us, well, look, there is so much, isn't there? There's a lot here, but if I had to choose one thing, call me an astro nerd if you want, but I am going to say that what I love about this week is Saturn. Yes, I said it. And I know it can make people cringe to think about Saturn that way, but when Saturn turns retrograde, it allows us to understand ourselves. It allows us to take ownership for our own state of being in our own lives. And more importantly, it helps us to understand where we have power and where we don't. And to even be able to contemplate that, I've come to realize what a privilege it actually is to be able to say, okay, I don't have power over this, so I'm just gonna let it go. I'm gonna leave it alone, right? Sometimes we don't have that choice. We have to deal with it. That's Saturn as well, saying to us, no, here it is. It's here right now. Be a grown-up and deal with it. And yeah, for some of us, this Saturn standing still in the sky and going retro is going to tell us that there is something we have to deal with, and it's going to help us to accept it. And that is actually a type of empowerment that Saturn promises. But for others of us, it is going to feel as if we are ready to embrace a more mature way of understanding where we have been and where it is that we want to go. We'll be more able to recognize our own power in a given situation to move our lives in a more stable direction. And thankfully, I do think that beautiful connection late in the week between Mercury and Jupiter, well, that will ensure that we stay positive, that we stay hopeful, and that we have every reason to be optimistic on this road towards greater love and greater wisdom as well. Well, thank you so much for watching. What do you love about this week? What are you excited about? How did last week go with Pluto station for you? Let me know in the comments below. I absolutely love reading you guys. I'm not sure if I'm doing this as a premiere just yet. I mean, I still have to edit the video and everything, but if this is showing up as a premiere, thank you to everybody who's joining me live and in real time. And if it isn't, or if you're not on the premiere, that's okay. Thank you for being here as part of the replay and as part of the week ahead forecast. I appreciate each and every one of you. Of course, if you want to know how all this wonderful stuff this week speaks to you and your sign, log on to nadiashaw.com. Sign up to be one of my superstars. Superstars get expanded, exclusive videoscopes each and every week, unlimited access to special horoscopes and more. All of this in the superstar space. I look forward to meeting you there. I've got big events coming up that I'm so excited about. I talked about conferences, you know, I mentioned it, and I didn't mean to mention it, but it came forward. And so now I'm saying it again. I got conferences coming up that I am super, super excited about. So, first, Vancouver. I will be in Vancouver May 9th and May 11th. Thursday, May 9th and Saturday, May 11th. On the Thursday, it is an evening talk. I'll be talking about luck and fortune in the astrology chart. And it is going to be on Saturday that it is a half-day workshop on life purpose in the astrology chart. We're gonna have a lot of fun. I mean, the Vancouver crew is incredible. I absolutely love Vancouver. If you've never been to Vancouver, you gotta go. The energy is just incredible there. The people are incredible there. And it always feels nice, like, to be back in Canada as well, because it's always home, you know? Yes, Mexico is home in many ways for me. Like, for almost 7 years now, I've been living in Mexico and I absolutely love it. But, you know, home is home. And for me, Canada is home. And I feel that embrace when I am in Vancouver. So I'm really looking forward to it. I'm being hosted by the Fraser Valley Astrology Guild. Thank you so much to everybody at the Fraser Valley Astrology Guild. They've just been so lovely to me, so supportive, and I appreciate them so much. So yes, I will link to it below. Click on, join me in Vancouver. If you're anywhere within a 1,000-mile radius or 1,000-kilometer radius, I mean, come on, I'm Canadian here. Memorial Day weekend, I will be at Norwalk in Seattle, one of the more renowned astrology conferences, truly a special event in Seattle, Washington. It's going to be my first time in Seattle, so I'm really excited about that, and my first time at Norwalk, speaking alongside some of the most renowned astrologers in the world today. It is truly an honor, and I look forward to meeting friends and fans there as well. I do think that the event is pretty much sold out, or there's a waiting list right now. If you're anywhere near the Seattle area, you can connect with them. And again, I'll link to it below, to the Norwalk conference, and you can find out. I do have a very limited number of consultations left. I think that there's just one more space left, given my schedule, that it's all set and I've already bought all my plane tickets and everything. I have one spot left in Vancouver and one in Seattle. So if it is that you would like an in-person consultation, you want to sit down with me, we'll have a private moment, I'll look at your chart, I'll answer your questions. I would love to make that happen. So reach out to me, use the contact form on my website, nadiashaw.com, and we can make that happen. And I will be in Baltimore. I'm really looking forward to being back in Baltimore as well at the NCGR conference. And that is going to be a lot of fun as well. I'm speaking, I don't remember if I'm speaking on one talk or two, but I know I'm speaking about signatures of long-term love, I think it is. Well, I'm speaking about something, and I'm speaking alongside a lot of incredible world-renowned astrologers as well, and it's going to be fabulous. It's going to be a big party. Norwalk is a party as well. I've heard good things about Norwalk, but I know the NCGR conferences because I've been to them before, and they are so much fun. And so yes, whether you are within 1,000 miles and 1,000 kilometers of Baltimore, or 1,000 kilometers of Seattle, or 1,000 kilometers of Vancouver, wherever you may be, or somewhere else, because I'm always in talks about going here, going there, because I absolutely love it. Finally, I am part of a truly unique cruise event. It is Love, Joy, and Hope, a transformational journey. We as a collective, along with some of the more renowned astrologers in the world, we're going to be out in the middle of the ocean, having an experience together, something that I truly believe is going to stay with us long after the cruise is over. And so I would invite you to learn more about that. We are going to be cruising underneath the exact conjunction of Saturn and Pluto. You know, these really are important times that a lot of us are in right now in our personal journeys, and of course as a collective as well. And for some people, it is more challenging to navigate than it may be for others, regardless of where you are on the spectrum of that. The great thing is with this is that it truly is about empowering each other and empowering ourselves to maintain hope, to remember love, even when going through challenging times, and to feel connected to the sky and to each other, to feel inspired. And so it really is a unique event. I'm so proud to be a part of it, and mostly because I have seen how events like this can truly transform lives and stay with you long after they are over. If it is something that feels like it karmically aligns with you, something that you are meant to do, to stargaze with us under the Saturn-Pluto conjunction in the middle of January, well then, I would love to see you there. You can log on to my website. Again, all links are below in the description. Learn more about the event. Once it is that you pay your deposit, you sign up, you will be connected with someone who can help you to get a roommate and can navigate with you to make sure that you are secured for your cabin and however it is that you want to do that, and however it is that we can help you and answer your questions, we are here for you. So yes, log on to my website, and I look forward to meeting you in this fabulous ship and sharing an incredible experience together. And thank you. Thank you for this incredible experience with you as well. Thank you for this moment with you. I'm truly so grateful for it all. And I will see you next week, of course, as always. And thank you. Until we connect again, take care. And it'll be a great week. Enjoy.